We're going to pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your calling upon our lives. Thank you, Lord, for your children. Lord, we're praying great, great blessings you pour upon everyone. We pray that this year there will be no exception to your blessings in Jesus' name. At home, bless your people. In the church, bless your people. At school, bless your people. In their work, bless your people. I will pray, Lord, your favor, your smile will be upon everyone. Lead us into your word right now and into the blessing of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're looking at 1 John chapter 2. I'm reading from verses 7 and 8. 1 John chapter 2, we're looking at verse 7. Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. As I've read that verse to you, you'll notice two words there. One, the old, and two, the new. It says, I'm not writing anything new to you, but the old that you have heard already. And then look at verse 8 now again. A new commandment I write unto you. In verse 7 it says, no, it's not new. Yes, it's old. That same old commandment I'm writing unto you. And then in verse 8 now it says, but now let's look at it another way. It says, a new commandment I write unto you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past and the true light now shineth. It says, it's going to be new because there's a new day. It's a new time. It's a new era. It's a new period. It says, because the darkness is gone. And so, in a way, what we're hearing is new. And yet, in another way, the word of God is still the same. It's still the old, old thing. Because you understand that he wants us to walk in that same old path he has given to us from the very beginning. You know, a time of prayer will never cease. Prayer is old and new. You think about peace with God, it's old and new. You think about purity, the purity of heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It's old, it's been given to us from the very beginning. And it is yet new. And a life of patience, that you are patiently walking with the Lord, and that you take the word of God serious every time. It's old and yet it's new. The power of the Holy Ghost. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the uttermost part of the earth. It's old and yet it's new. What are we going to talk about? Humility. That he wants us to walk humbly with our God. He wants us to put away pride. It's old and yes, it's new. Honesty. He wants us to be honest in everything that we do. He wants us to be transparently holy. That holiness of life without which no man shall see the Lord. It's old and yet it's new. Watchfulness. He calls upon us and he says, watch and be ready, for that day will come at a time you're not expecting. It's an old instruction and yet it's new. I'm talking to you today on walking in the old path with new strength. As I said, I'm talking to you today on walking in the old path with new strength. And I'm going to divide the message to three parts. Number one, waiting expectantly for Christ's return. Waiting expectantly for Christ's return. If there's any time we need to wait for the return of the Lord, and we need to be very much expectant as we wait upon the Lord, it's now. As we look at all the signs around you, and you look at what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, and in Luke chapter 21, and in Mark chapter 13, you look at all the signs he gave, and he said, when you see all these signs, you know that I am near at the door. This is the time to wait expectantly for Christ's return. Number two, walking earnestly until Christ's return. Walking earnestly until Christ's return. He had said, occupy until I come. And if there's any time to think about What are you doing for the Lord? What have you done for the Lord? How far have you gone with the Lord? How far have you gone for the Lord? This is the time to think about it. And your service to the Lord, how acceptable is it in the sight of the Lord? This is the time to think about that. And you work earnestly until Christ return. And then witnessing eagerly before Christ's return. Witnessing. That's the work he has given you. When he said he shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. When he comes back, he's going to check up, like he checked off from those people that he gave the talents to. And how many talents have you won? Well, the five he gave you, well, the two he gave you, or well, the one he gave you, or are you burying your talent in the earth, witnessing eagerly before Christ's return? We're looking at number one, waiting expectantly for Christ's return. Waiting expectantly for Christ's return. I learned of a particular man who was to keep the garden of a particular house. And the master, the boss, the owner of that house, the landlord, traveled out. And for many years he had not returned. And this gardener kept the place so neat and so trimmed that the visitor then commented and said, why is it you are cleaning up the house like this and you're making the garden like this when your master has not been around for a long time, many, many years? Are you cleaning the house in such a way that he might come tomorrow? I said, no, not really. I clean up the day as if he might come today. As if he might come today. And that's the attitude a child of God ought to have. The Lord may come today. Glad day, glad day. What a glorious day it will be. He may come today. And if he is going to come today, you need to be waiting expectantly for his return. That's what the Thessalonians did. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, we're reading from verse 8. It says, for from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith to God's word is spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. Can we say that about your faith? Can we say that about your conversion? Can we say that about your experience of salvation? That your life is so clear, your life is so clean, and your life is so radiant, that as we get to the place where you have been before, just shining your radiant light, we don't need to speak anything, because through your life, they know about that salvation. For many people, we cannot say that. For many people cannot say that because of your radiant life, your shining life, your sinless life, your good life, your holy life, your life above reproach. Everybody now knows about salvation. Everybody around you, they know about the depth of salvation. They know about all the things, you know, implied in salvation. That's what you need to do this year. Why did they do that? Look at verse 9. It says, for they themselves show for us what manner of entering we urge unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his son from heaven. And to wait for his son from heaven. And that's the attitude they urge. Every day, every time, they were waiting for the coming of Christ, and to wait for his son whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. They had been saved, they had been delivered from the wrath to come, and because of that, they were waiting expectantly. And the Lord is telling us this year, you don't know, he might come just that time temptation comes to you. He might come when you want to, when you have the tendency of going back to that foolish thing you had dropped in the past. He might come when you start that fight with your wife. He might come when you start that evil thing in the place of work where you are working. And because of that, say, no, I can't do that. I can't go that direction. He might come today. He might come before I have a chance to repent and make right my way. Because of that, I want to keep on watching and waiting. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 5. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 5. It says in verse 5, and the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. The Lord direct your heart. Let the Lord control your life this year, control your attitude this year. Whatever happens, whatever does not happen, whatever you're expecting, be patient. And let the Lord himself grant you that thing at his own time. Habakkuk tells us something very important. Old Testament Habakkuk, he tells us about, waiting. He tells us about tarrying. He tells us about our expectation. And he says, even though you might not have received that thing, don't grumble because of that. Don't deny the Lord because of that. And don't go away from the Lord because of that. Wait expectantly. And as you wait expectantly, and as you are tarrying and waiting for that promise to come upon your life, and you are waiting for the fulfillment of what God said he will do, he says, it will come, it will surely come. And then he reminds you that you must keep on living by faith, expecting by faith. We're looking at Habakkuk chapter 2. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 3. It says, for the vision is yet for an appointed time. For the promise is yet for an appointed time. And for the declaration is yet for an appointed time. That vision is for an appointed time. But at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it. Because it will surely come, it will not tarry. All the promises the Lord has made for you this year, they will surely come, they will not tarry. There will be a fulfillment in your life in Jesus' name. Then he goes on to say, verse 4, behold, a soul that is lifted up is not upright in him. God hates pride. And he wants us very carefully this year to make sure that everything we say is all in humility. You're talking about yourself. You know, in the past we were so conscious about this humble attitude. We never speak about ourselves when talking to people. We do not try to project ourselves. We do not try to blow our trumpets. We allow the Lord to do that. And of course, when you come to the church, you know, there are some people, they cannot finish any message without talking about, I want to tell you something about my child. When my child was 2 years of age, when my child was 5 years of age, and this happened, every time, in every message, they must give illustration about their child. Isn't that pride? Your child is the most, the most talked about person in the church. Let's suspend all that this year. And let's get rid of all that this year. And sometimes it's not about your child. It's about, my wife. I want to tell something. And every time in the church on Sunday, while you're preaching, while you're saying something, it's my wife. Can we suspend that this year? And have the attitude of humility. You know, when I was in college, we also went to college. Let's suspend that this year. When I was here, when I was there, let's suspend that this year. It says, behold, a soul which is lifted up in him is not upright in him. But the just shall live by his faith. The just shall live by faith. All the, blowing the trumpet and lifting up ourselves and, making people to know, we talk about Jesus a few minutes, we talk about ourselves a few minutes, and let's leave all that this year, and the Lord himself will lift up the humble in Jesus' name. And look at Hebrews chapter 10, this is exactly what we've read in Habakkuk, now interpreted for us in Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 37. For yet a little while, he that shall come and will not tarry. It's reminding us Christ is coming. And because Christ is coming, that's the reason we need to live by faith. That's the reason we need to make our lives totally depend upon the Lord without looking back. There's no time to backslide this year. There's no time to go astray this year. There's no time to go into false doctrine this year, because the time of the coming of the Lord is very near. For a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. Have you noticed that exactly the arrangement you find in Habakkuk, that's what you find here. When he says the promise is coming, the prophecy will be fulfilled, the vision is for an appointed time, and the appointed time is very near. And he says the just will live by faith. The same thing he's saying here. The one who is coming will come. Christ is coming. Christ is coming. I pray we'll meet you prepared. It says, now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, My soul shall have no pleasure in him. If anyone draws back because this has not been done, that has not been done, I don't understand this, I don't understand that. If you draw back, he says, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But thank God, verse 39, but we are not of them who draw back unto perdition. Those who draw back, what do they draw back to? They draw back to perdition. There are people that tell us, once you are saved, you are forever saved. Even if you draw back, they say, you'll still draw back into heaven. You'll draw back into paradise. You'll draw back into the eternal love of God. He has always loved you, and it doesn't matter whether you backslide or not. If you die like that, you will wake up in Abraham's bosom. Not really, not really. Look at what it says. We're not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul, to the preservation of the soul. I pray the Lord will preserve your soul, preserve my soul in Jesus' name. In Luke chapter 12, it tells us we need to be watching and waiting, waiting for the coming of the Lord. And these are the words of Jesus Christ himself. In Luke chapter 12, here reading from verse 34. Luke chapter 12, verse 34. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You know what? If your treasure is in heaven, your heart will be in heaven. If your treasure is in Christ, in God, your heart will be in Christ, will be in God. If your treasure is in the church, is you love the church, you honor the church, you appreciate the church, you know that the source of your joy is that church because of the teaching of the word of God. If your treasure is in the church, your heart will be in the church. But if your treasure is in the world, your heart will be in the world. If your treasure is in the dancing hall, your heart will be there. If your treasure is in all the merriments and all the chieftaincy titles and the politics of the world, that's where your heart will be. But if you're expecting the Lord, if you're waiting for the coming of the Lord, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. It says, let your loins be girded about and your lights burning, and ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord. You yourself like unto men that wait for their Lord. Have you seen people who are waiting for the arrival of maybe their husband or their wife from overseas, and they go to the airport, and all the other people at the airport, they are milling here and there, they are going here and there, but they're just there. Maybe they are there to sell currency, maybe they are there to just do whatever, maybe they are there like touts, and you know they're not waiting for anything. But as you see that man waiting for the wife and to come from overseas, you know the way she'll pay attention when they make announcement that a plane has arrived, and then he's looking, he wants to receive the wife. He says that's the way he should be eager, that's the way he should be expectant, as men waiting for something important, waiting for their Lord. He goes on to say, when he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Blessed are those servants whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. There are people that tell us that there's no preparation to be made. There's no watching to be done. That once you are born again, you are born again. And when Christ comes, everybody will go. That's what they say. But Jesus said no, that if you're going to receive the Lord when he comes, you will be watching so that when he knocks, when he comes, immediately you'll open. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. You'll not be missing on that day. We need to have that hope in us. And that hope will make you to do quite a few things. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. Acts of the Apostles chapter 24, reading from verse 15 and verse 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 24, reading from verse 15. Acts chapter 24. Here in verse 15, look at what it says. It tells us in verse 15, and it says, and have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. Here is Paul the apostle, and he's saying, I have hope in the Lord. I'm waiting. A time of resurrection is coming. A time when the dead shall rise, and then we which are alive, we shall be changed like in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. It says, because of that, I have hope. Hope for the resurrection. Hope for the rapture. What does that hope do for him? Look at this in verse 16. And herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. It says, because I'm expecting the coming of the Lord, I don't want any time my conscience to be offensive. My conscience to feel the guilt that I've done something I shouldn't have done. I've gone where I shouldn't have gone. I have eaten what I shouldn't have eaten. I've drunk what I shouldn't have drunk. I've related with the world in a way that is blameworthy. That the Lord will say, why could you do that? His conscience was kept clean and clear, righteous and honest and holy and guiltless, because he was expecting the Lord. But you know, there are some people that live as if they have no conscience at all. As if their consciences are seared with a hot iron. As if their consciences are totally dead or deadened, because you know, they just act anyhow. And other people that see them, you'll be feeling, how could he do that? How could he go that way? How could he dress like that? But you know, he doesn't have any conscience like that. But Paul the apostle is saying that if you're expecting the coming of the Lord, and you're waiting, and you have that hope, it says your conscience will be sensitive to anything that will offend God, anything that will offend your neighbor. It goes on to say in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. It's talking of the people that died. Those who have died, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. It says, when your relative dies, don't, if he is born again, a real child of God, then you will not be sorrowful as others that have no hope. Because you know that he died in the Lord, she died in the Lord, and because she died in the Lord, that's, we know that she's gone to be with the Lord. He has gone to be with the Lord. Therefore, you will not be sorrowful and be mourning for, you know, for the rest of your life. Look at this again. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that she sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so also, which them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. Talking about the resurrection of the dead. When Christ comes, those who have died in Christ, they will rise up first. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede them, prevent them, hinder them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Then it says, wherefore, because we know he is coming, wherefore, because we know the dead shall rise, wherefore, because we know that those of us who are alive in Christ, we shall be changed and everything will turn around. It says, wherefore, because of that, comfort one another with these words. It's a comforting hope. The hope we have in the Lord, that the Lord is coming. And when something happens that looks, why should this happen? I don't understand this. This is painful. Why this persecution? Why this problem? Why this suffering? Remember the coming of the Lord and comfort yourself with the coming of the Lord, that all these problems you face, they'll soon be over. And the Lord, when he comes, he'll reward you for your faithfulness in Jesus' name. It tells us in 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Reading from verse 1, it says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. The world knoweth us not. Does that mean they don't know that, you know, we're living here around them? Of course they know. They don't know a house address. Of course they know. They don't know that we are going to the same school as they are going. Of course they know. They don't know that we are walking in the same place. Of course they know. What it means is they don't recognize us. They don't appreciate us. We don't dress like they dress. They don't accept that. They don't appreciate that. We don't drink with them. They don't accept that. They don't appreciate that. We don't do funny things with them. They don't appreciate that. We'll not allow ourselves to be their boyfriend or their girlfriend or their sugar daddy or whatever. They don't appreciate that. That's what it says. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. The Pharisees knew Jesus. They knew that that's Jesus. They asked him questions, but they didn't recognize him. They didn't appreciate him. They wouldn't give him any office, because they said, it's not, going along with us. The same thing if you're a child of God. In your family, they may push you aside. In your extended family, that's what I mean. They may push you aside because they say, he will not worship idol with us. He'll not do that. He'll not give you the recognition they give to other members of the family. Beloved, now are we the sons of God? Yeah, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But it says, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. What does that hope do for you? That you'll be with him. You'll see him as he is, and you'll be like him. Look at what that hope will do. It's a sanctifying hope. If you have hope in the Lord, you'll want to be sanctified. You'll not be saying every time, well, I know I'm a Christian. Yes, I know I'm not sanctified. I know I'm not holy. I know I'm not matured. I know I'm not this and that. But all the same, I thank God I'm a child of God. If you are hoping for his coming, if you have hope that when he comes, you'll not be ashamed. You'll not be talking like that. Look at verse 3. And every man that has this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. You see, the hope of seeing the Lord is a preventive hope. That is a hope that prevents us from going into sin. A hope that prevents us from defiling our conscience. It's not only that, it's a practical hope. A practical hope that makes you to be conscious of the fact that he's coming. And because he's coming, I can't do that, I can't go there, I can't do that. Because it's a practical hope. It's a pacifying hope. It's a hope that makes you be at peace with people. Because you know you need to follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. It's a persevering hope. A hope that makes you to endure. I'll endure that. I will stay cool in that. I'll not allow that to jolt me or to disturb me or to kind of make me take a step I shouldn't take. It's a persevering hope. It's a perfecting hope. It's perfecting you every time. I know it's coming. And because it's coming, I want my way and I want my life to be perfected. All the imperfections of your life, all the things that are not according to the will of God in your life, you want to push all that aside. And you want to say, yes, Lord, perfection is my dream. Perfection is my desire. And perfection is what I demand when I pray. I want your love to be perfected in me. I want your truth to be perfected in me. And I want my way to be perfect before you. Because you see, if you're expecting the coming of the Lord, you want all those imperfections to be cleansed away, all those imperfections to be taken away, and you are telling the Lord, oh Lord, perfect me. I want to move on to perfection. I want to grow unto perfection. I want to be what you want me to be. And what you want me to be is what you told Abraham when you said, Abraham, walk thou before me and be thou perfect. And that is what I want. And the grace to do that, it will do it in your life in Jesus' name. That hope we have, the hope of seeing the Lord on the final final day, a preserving hope. And it is a preventing hope. It is a perfecting hope. It is a practical hope. And it is a pacifying hope. It is a purifying hope. He that has this hope in himself, every man that has this hope in himself, purifies himself even as he is pure. And I pray that this expectation will be in your heart, in my heart, in our hearts, in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, it tells us, if you're expecting the coming of the Lord and you're waiting for that coming of the Lord, here is how you'll be in a state of readiness, a state of preparedness, and a state of watchfulness. Hebrews chapter 3, I'm looking at verse 6, it says, but Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope. The hope you have of his coming, you hold that firm until unto the end. You hold that hope fast until the very end. Look at verse 12. It says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. It says, if you are hoping to see him on that final day, if you are hoping to be ready on that final day, and if you are hoping to hear when the trumpet shall sound, it says that you will not allow any deceitfulness of sin to make you depart from the Lord. In verse 13, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you should be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. We hold that beginning of the hope we have steadfast unto the end. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1 is telling us here from verse 3. 1 Peter chapter 1, it tells us from verse 3, it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us unto a lively hope. A lively hope, that's the hope that keeps you alive spiritually. You know, without that hope, you could easily be derailed. Without that hope, you could easily backslide. Without that hope, you could easily become dead in sins and trespasses. But it says, it keeps us a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. There are things you'll not get until you get to heaven. And if you don't get to heaven, there are things you'll never have. They are reserved for you in heaven. That's why you say, I'll keep on keeping on. I'll keep on being faithful. I'll keep on depending upon the Lord. I'll keep on looking unto him, the author and the finisher of my faith. I'll keep on laying aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset. I'll keep on being faithful, loyal, honest, and I'll keep on obeying his commandment, because he says, so I kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. The final salvation, ready to be revealed in the final day. And number two now is walking earnestly until Christ's return. Walking earnestly until Christ's return. He's giving us work to do. He's giving us assignment to do. And he wants us to work. He wants us to do what he has appointed for us to do. He tells us in the light of his coming, he gives us assignment. In the light of his coming, he gives us responsibility. In the light of his coming, he gives us a duty to perform. He tells us in Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 34. Mark chapter 13, verse 34. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work. He's talking about himself. And he says, the Son of Man is like this householder. He's going on a far journey. He's gone to heaven. And then as he's gone, he's given all the members of the household authority to the servants and to every man his work, and commanded the potter to watch. And then he says, watch ye therefore, For ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at evening, or at midnight, or at the crowing of the, at the crowing, at cock crowing, or in the morning. Lest coming suddenly, he find you sleeping. You know, Jesus Christ warned his disciples. He didn't give them an idea as to say, whatever happens, you'll make it. Whether you're watching or not, you'll make it. Whether you are ready or not, that doesn't matter, you'll make it. He says, no, you must be watching. And then he said what he told his disciples, he's telling everyone else that comes into the kingdom, and watch, I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. He wants you to watch. And as you watch, I pray that you'll be ready on that final day in Jesus' name. He's giving us work to do. How do we do that work? How do we commit ourselves to the work he has given us to do? He's giving us work to do in the church. He's giving us work to do in our families. He's giving us work to do to our neighbors. In the church, you have responsibility. He wants you to do it as he, Christ himself, would have done it. In your family, is giving you responsibility. He wants you to do that as he, Christ himself, would have done it. And to your neighbors, he has given you responsibility of evangelizing. He wants you to do that as he, Christ himself, would have done it. What has given you to be in the church? What has he committed yet to your hand in the church? And how are you doing that? Have the mind of Christ in you and the attitude of Christ in you as you do all he has called you to do. Look at John chapter 9 verse 4. John chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 4. It says, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. It says, I must. You have that must on you. You say, this is what he has committed into my hands. And because of that, I must work the works of him that sent me. You know that you are sent where you are. You're sent by the Lord himself. That's the attitude Jesus had. That's the attitude you ought to have. There are many people that will carelessly say, okay, I will not be in that place again. Because you didn't realize God sent you there. God committed that into your hand. God said, that is what you do. But Jesus was conscious of the calling of God upon his life every time. Of the fact that he was sent by the Father. And he said that many times. And if you're like Jesus Christ, you're going to say that yourself. You're going to say that your family. You're going to say that your neighbors. And a little sin will not discourage you and make you run away from your post of duty. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can walk. In John chapter 4, John chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 34. John chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus says unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. Again, he repeated the fact, I am sent. Do you know you are sent? Do you know you are sent? And would you leave that post of duty if you knew you were sent by the Lord himself? And with what attitude, or what mind, with what love, with what affection, and with what concentration will you do it if you were really conscious the Lord sent you to do it? Now, if you say, well, I'm not sure the Lord sent me to do this, but I'm going to do it anyhow, why should you do it if the Lord has not sent you to do it? That's what causes problem in your own personal life. You're not sure this is what the Lord wants you to do, and I'm going to do it anyhow. I'm not sure this is what the Lord wants me to say. I'm going to say it anyhow. I'm not sure the Lord wants me to go there. I'm going to go there anyway. That's what causes problem in your life. Jesus Christ knew. He was a saint man. He was a saint Messiah. He was a saint master. He tells us, Jesus says unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. And to finish his work. Look at Paul the Apostle. He had that notion too. He had that understanding too. He had that conviction too. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, working earnestly until Christ's return. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, reading from verse 19. Here is the testimony of Paul the Apostle, whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. All the vision that some people have is an earthly vision. It's a temporary vision. It's a mundane vision. It's a vision for things that will not last. It's a vision that will not be rewarded. For Paul the apostle said, there's an heavenly vision. That's what the Lord has given to me. And he said, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. What did he do as a result of that? But showed forth unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet fit suitable for repentance. That's the vision the Lord gave him. That's the vision he has given us to. That's the work he has given us to do. And look at Ephesians chapter 4, reading here from verse 11. And concentrating on that work, the work he has given to do. There are many people that could have said, or that could say, I was busy here and there, therefore my real primary assignment I have neglected. And my real primary assignment is, is in shambles because I've concentrated on other things, which is not what the Lord has given me to do. In Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4. Reading from verse 11, it says, and he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors, and some teachers. Well, you might not be an apostle, but he's giving you something to do. You might not be a prophet, but he's giving you something to do. Yeah, you might not be an evangelist, that is a national, international evangelist, but he's giving you something to do. You might not be a pastor, you might not be a teacher, but he's giving you something to do. Maybe he's giving you to be a father over children, and those children need to know the Lord. He's giving you to be a mother over some children, and those children need to know the Lord. He's giving you to be a leader over the youth, and those youths, they need to know the Lord. He's giving you a work to do among those students on the campus. That's what he has given you. And you don't need to say, I want to be an apostle. I want what you're doing and what he has given you to do is enough for you to do. And that's what he will reward. But he tells us now, the reason why he gave you that work to do, for the perfecting of the saints. You see that? For the perfecting of the saints. And if you're working for the Lord honestly, that purpose will be in your mind. That purpose will be in your mind all the time you're ministering, is for the perfecting of the saints. This is what the Lord has given me to do. This is what the Lord has, the assignment he has given you. The way I am doing it, is it perfecting the saints? Is it maturing the saints? Is it stabilizing the saints? Is it making the saints to stand firm in the knowledge of the word of God? Or is it making the saints to become sinners, to backslide? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Am I edifying the body? Am I tearing down the body? Am I building up the body? Or am I scattering the body? Am I making the body of Christ more healthy and more holy and more happy? Or am I making the body of Christ to be sad and sorrowful and to be dejected and to be regretting that he came to that service that day? And it says we keep on doing that till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children in the house fellowship and in the area of what we're doing. The people we are influencing, are they still childish? Are they still careless? Are they still immature? Are they just people who are churchgoers, or they have real knowledge of the word of God? That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine and by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby the lie in which to deceive. He wants us to do the work like he himself would have done it. And if we're going to do it like that, our character will show. Our character will be affected. And as we come to this new year, look at what the Lord is telling us in verse 25. It says, wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor. Putting away lying, let's put away lying completely as we speak to our neighbors. you're relating with, you know, members of the church, tell the truth. If you're relating with the leaders, tell the truth. If you are answering questions in the Sunday scripture time, tell the truth. And whatever it is, we don't cover up anything. It says in our relationship, if we're going to do the work like Christ would have done the work, it says we're telling the truth. You know, sometimes we want to protect Peter, but Jesus will not do that. Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. He was talking about Peter in the presence of the rest of the disciples. That's how Jesus will approach it. Just be transparently true in everything you do and everything you say. And he spoke about Jesus, about Judas Iscariot. He said, that thing you did, do quickly, but it were better you were not born if that thing is done. If we just appreciate the truth and love the truth and give out the truth, whoever is affected, whoever is not affected, so that people will repent and people will turn to the Lord. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor. And then he says, for we are members one of another. Look at verse 20. Let him that stole steal no more. That's the influence of our ministry. If you're ministering in the church and you're helping other people to know the Lord, you're telling them, let him that stole steal no more. Let him that lied lie no more. Let him that was immoral be immoral no more. And let him that sinned sin no more. That's the ministry. And that is the goal that the Lord is calling us to as we're walking earnestly until Christ returns. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather, let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. It says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Anytime, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Then he goes on to say, but that which is good to the use of edifying. That is, anybody you are speaking to, not that you speak, they become sad. You speak, they decide they're going to backslide. You speak, they decide they're going to be unfaithful. You speak, they decide they're going to fight. You speak, and then, you know, something negative happens. It says, let no corrupt communication come proceed out of your mouth. But that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. May minister grace unto the hearers. May minister grace unto the hearers. And it goes on to say in verse 30, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed until the day of redemption. Then it says, let all bitterness, and let all wrath, and let, what's the next word there? Tell me out loud. You know, there are families where there's anger all the time. From morning till evening, there's always something they fight about, always something they quarrel about, always something they are angry about. And you know, they might be nice to people outside, praise the Lord, wonderful, and have a smile on their faces, but then when they go inside their rooms, instead of love, there is anger. But the Lord is saying, this year, no anger again in Jesus' name. It says, let all bitterness, you know, you're bitter about this, about that. Are you expecting the coming of the Lord? And then it says, all wrath, and all anger, and all clamor. You know, sometimes husband and wife, they're talking inside the house, they're shouting about something, and then people outside are hearing. And they say, this deeper life, a family, what are they always crying about, shouting about? That will stop this year in Jesus' name. And then, you know, the husband is saying, okay, eat your food. I don't want to eat. What's the matter? You know, I don't want to deceive myself. I'm hot. I'm this. I'm that. I can't eat now. Well, you might have ulcer, though. Be very careful. This year, let all quarrels be settled. I said, let all quarrels be settled. Why it not for church? Why it not for deeper life? I would have kicked you out and divorced you. We don't say that this year, because this year is a year of love. And it's a year of patience with one another in Jesus' name. But you need to work at it. You need to do something. If we're sanctified, all that anger will not be there. Bitterness will not be there. All that irritating each other, and all that wanting to provoke another person, all that will not be there. There'll be joy in your heart to serve the Lord, and joy in your heart to live in the family. And therefore, bitterness will pass away in Jesus' name. Wrath will pass away in Jesus' name. And the anger will clear away in Jesus' name. And the clamor, the shouting on each other, all that will clear away in Jesus' name. And then he says, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Look at verse 32 now. And be kind. Be kind. That word coming out is that kind. That attitude is that kind. That disposition is that kind. You check up yourself this year. Don't just live and don't just act somehow and say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You're dealing with a member of the body of Christ. So dealing with somebody that God loves and God has appointed, and be kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. And that's what's giving you to, that's what's giving us to do this year. That's what we're going to do in Jesus' name. Live a holy life, live a righteous life, live a loving life, live an affectionate life, and live a life that will make other people happy. They are in the family of God. In 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 2. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. In our various districts, in our various local churches, in our various regions, in our various states and nations, and we don't, give the ministry like a toy. You know, to people that, you know, to pacify them, to just, you know, make them keep quiet. They're opposing the church and they're opposing our leadership, and to bribe them, we give them position. We don't do that. We don't do that. That will stop this year. And if you have been giving positions to people on that basis out of fear, the fear of man, if we don't give him that to do, he might, spoil the work for us. If we don't give him that to do, he might disturb us one way or the other. If you've been doing that, all those responsibilities you gave out before on that wrong basis, you take those things away. You go to those people and say, brother, I'm sorry I told you to do that. I was really afraid of you. And because I was afraid, that's why I gave you. But now we have learned you are not going to give out position in the church, ministry in the church, out of fear, out of giving toys to, you know, pacify some troublemakers in the church. If they are troublemakers, they are not born again. If they are not born again, there's no reason to give them responsibility. Look at verse 2 again. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit to faithful men. Faithful men are saved men. Faithful men are sanctified people. Faithful men are submissive people. And faithful men are people that have ability to teach, who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life. Then it goes on to say that he may please him. He may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he see not crowned, except he strive lawfully. Look at verse 21. In verse 21, if a man therefore purge himself from these, it shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lusts, and but follow righteousness and faith and charity and peace with them that call on the Lord out of what kind of heart? A pure heart. We're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. 2 Timothy chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 2. It says, preach the word. That's what you do this year. Let your life do that. Preach the word. Let your attitude do that. preach the word, and let your relationships do that. Preach the word, and let your activities, your place of work, do that. Let them know that, let them call you pastor, let them call you Mary the Virgin, let them call you whatever name. Preach the word. Let everything you do, your dressing, preach your word. Your actions, preach the word. Your lifestyle, preach the word. And your movements, preach the word. Your interactions, your associations, your friendship, preach the word. And let people know that this is a man of the word and a woman of the word. Not just because you are standing at the pulpit, but because you're living the life that is giving out the word of God. Be instant in season and out of season. There are times you might, you know, be under pressure. That's the time to take care to preach the word. There are times you might be, you know, among enemies that are watching for, you know, your compromise. That's the time to preach the word. There are times you might be among the people that, you know, they are fearsome, or they are fearful, or they are frightening, and they're looking at you like lions, as if you dare not do that yet. That's the time to preach the word. Preach the word. Be instant in season when it's convenient, out of season when it's not convenient, when it's tough and difficult, when it's challenging. That's when to preach the word with your life, with your lips, with everything you do, and reprove and rebuke and exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own laws shall give to themselves teachers having itching ears. They shall turn away from their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. When that is happening in society, that's when to preach the word. But watch thou in all things endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Isn't that the work he has given us to do? Soul winning. He tells us, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of your ministry. And I pray you'll be faithful to the end in Jesus' name. In 2 Peter chapter 3, 2 Peter chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 10. 2 Peter chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 10. The assignment he has given us, the duty he has laid upon us, working earnestly until Christ return. We're looking at it from verse 10. It says in verse 10, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall melt, shall pass away with great heat, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. Notice that the work of the works in the world, everything shall be burnt up. And if all you do is the work in the world, I don't have time for the work in the church, I don't have time for choir practice, I don't have time for preparatory for the workers on Tuesday or Saturday, I don't have time to be in that committee, I'm so busy, I'm here and there. Look at that verse 10 again, the latter part. It says, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. If everything you're doing in the world is being prepared for the fire, when the Lord shall come, what gain do you have? If you gain the whole world and lose your soul, or you lose your reward in heaven. It says in verse 11, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, all the things you are trying to build up on earth, in the world, everything shall be dissolved. What manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for that, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire, the skies being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace and without spot and blameless. I pray that when it comes, you'll not be ashamed in Jesus' name. Number one is waiting expectantly for Christ's return. Number two is walking earnestly until Christ's return. Number three is witnessing eagerly before Christ's return. If you are getting ready for the coming of the Lord, here is what we need to do. He's giving us a work to do, to witness, to win souls, and to bring people to know the Lord. That's what he did when he was here, and that's what he expects you to do as he has left you in the world today. In Luke chapter 19, we're reading from verse 10, to first of all see what he did, and to see what he concentrated on, and to see what is calling you and calling every believer to concentrate on. It says in Luke chapter 19 verse 10, for the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. The Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Any lost person around you? Any lost person in your family? Any lost person in your neighborhood? Any lost person around you there? What would Jesus do if Jesus was around them? But the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost, and now he's passed that on to us. Look at verse 13. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. Occupy till I come. He's coming and he wants us to occupy until he comes. Let's come back to this John chapter 4. John chapter 4. We'll see his attitude, you see his devotion, you see his dedication, you see his commitment and consecration to the work the Father has given him to do. Verse 34. Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Look at the next verse now. What he expects of you, what he expects of me. As he has shown us the example, as he has shown us the pattern. It says, say not ye, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. It says, are you delaying? Are you saying, it's not time yet, I need to finish this? It's not time yet, I need to go to that other place? It's not time yet, I need to concentrate on other things? It says, don't say that there are yet 4 months and then the harvest will come. It says, look on the fields, they're white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal. For both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that same fulfilled. Is that same true? One soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap. He's sending us. And he's saying, I sent you something to do. Souls to be won, and backsliders to be restored, and the saints to be edified and established. He says, I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye are entered into their labors. Look at John chapter 17. John chapter 17. I'm reading from verse 17 all through to verse 18. John chapter 17. We read from verse 17 and verse 18. What he's giving us to do is what he himself had done. In verse 17 it says, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. And as thou hast sent me into the world, as the Father has sent him into the world, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. Who are the them here? He sent to the world. The people he prayed for, sanctify them. And if he has prayed for you, a man, a woman, a boy, a girl, young, old, illiterate or educated, is prayed for you to be sanctified, and you are praying that you'll be sanctified with the efficacy of the blood of Jesus, then he says, as the Father has sent him, even so as he sent all the sanctified people into the world, that they will preach the word of the Lord. Look at Mark chapter 1 and see how he did that work that the Father sent him to do, and how he expects you and I to do the work the Father or Christ is sending us to do. In Mark chapter 1 verse 36. Mark chapter 1 verse 36. And Simon and they that were with him followed after him. And when they had found him, they said unto him, all men seek thee. All men appreciate you. They want you to stay here. All men seek you. They want you to be around them and give them more of this that they have got. And look at what he said in verse 38. And he said unto them, let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also. For therefore came I forth. That's how he did it. He preached somewhere, and then he still says, stay with us there. He said, we need to go to the next town, to the next place, to the next neighbor, to the people that are waiting, that have not heard. As T.L. Osborne used to say, nobody has a right to hear the gospel two times when millions have not heard once. And we can't say nobody has a right to hear this word 10 times over when there are so many people that have not heard even once. Or we might say nobody has a right to hear 100 times when there are so many people have not heard once. And the Lord is telling us to go to the people that have not heard and give them the gospel. Let there be a must in your life, that I must do the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can walk. That's what the Lord said about Paul the apostle. Something he must do. That's what he's saying about you. Something you must do. Acts chapter 23 verse 11. Acts 23, I'm reading from verse 11. It says, and the night following, the Lord stood by him and said, be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so must thou bear witness also at Rome. You've done it here, you must do it in another place too. That's why he said in Romans chapter 1 verse 16, it says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, and to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. The Lord is calling upon you as a child of God. The Lord is calling upon you as a Christian, a scriptural Christian, a Bible Christian, that we need to get the word out to other people and get people saved. And say like Paul the apostle, that necessity is laid upon me. Woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. Acts chapter 8 verse 4. The early church all went out, members of the church, everybody in the church. They knew that this is what they ought to do, and they actually did it. They were not just thinking about it, hearing about it, planning about it. They actually did it. Acts chapter 8 verse 4. Therefore they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. This year is a year of preaching the word. A year of soul winning, a year of sanctification, a year of bringing many people to know the Lord in Jesus' name. A Christian that will please the Lord will be like Enoch. What kind of person will he be? He'll be a saved Christian. My question to you is, are you saved? Are you born again? Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. Are you living above sin? Are you a saved Christian? A person that will please the Lord will be a sanctified Christian. Are you sanctified? Do you have that holiness without which no man shall see the Lord? Is your heart sanctified? Your soul sanctified? Your spirit sanctified? Your intention sanctified? Everything you do sanctified? And the Lord can say, that's a sanctified man, a sanctified woman there. A person who is going to please the Lord will not be carnal, will be a spiritual Christian, a spirit-filled Christian, a spirit-controlled Christian. Does the Spirit dwell in you, the Holy Ghost? Does the Spirit control you, the Holy Ghost? And does it lead you, does he lead you in everything you do? A saved Christian, a sanctified Christian, a spiritual Christian, a soul-winning Christian. Many years you spent already almost wasted. How many people have you brought to the Lord in real experience of salvation? A real Christian that will please the Lord will be a second coming Christian, you believe in the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you believe that the rapture is imminent, and you're living like that, that's a Christian that will please the Lord. Is a submissive Christian, a person that say, I submit my life, I submit my heart, I submit everything I've got to the Lord, and this year I don't want to rebel, I don't want to disobey, I don't want to do anything contrary to the will of the Lord. A saved Christian, a sanctified Christian, a spiritual, spirit-filled, spirit-controlled Christian, a soul-winning Christian, a second-coming Christian, a submissive Christian, a serving Christian, serving the Lord. Somebody who says, I'll serve the Lord this year, I'll serve the Lord. Every moment, I'll serve the Lord. Every opportunity, I will serve the Lord. The Lord wants you to examine yourself and say, what kind of Christian am I? Waiting expectantly? Am I walking earnestly? Am I witnessing eagerly? Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Talk to the Lord in prayer that this year you'll be a Christian that will please the Lord. A Christian that will live a life like Enoch, that should the trumpet sound anytime this year, and then the dead in Christ are raised up, and those of us who are alive will go with the Lord, that you will be among the people that will go with the Lord. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, I want to be, Lord, I want to be, Lord, I want to be a Christian that is going to walk in newness of nature, a new heart, a new conscience, a new lifestyle, and I'm going to glorify the Lord this year, fulfilling his will. I'm falling, all that will stop. I have no food to eat, food has come. No job, job has come. I am not married, send your invitation card to me. I don't have children, the children, miracle children have come. This year will be different. The favor of God will multiply in your life. Your family life will be happy. I said your family life will be happy. Things are going to turn around for the better. The joy of the Lord will be your strength. Take all that sorrow away. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you today. We know that you are there for your people. And Lord, I pray for everyone here today. I pray that your blessing will come upon them in Jesus' name. Be a real father to them, a real supplier to them, and a real giver to them. Every good thing they desire, oh Lord, I pray, give unto them in Jesus' name. I pray that all powers of darkness in their lives will crumble. Powers of darkness in their families will crumble. All the negative things, oh Lord, you destroy them in Jesus' name. Every work of the devil will be stopped. And I pray that this year will be a year of progress, a year of plenty, a year of prosperity, a year of your power. And I pray, oh Lord, no lack in any life this year in Jesus' name. Our students will make progress. Our youth will move forward. Every closed door before them open in Jesus' name. Our papas, our mamas, oh Lord, I pray your blessing will come upon the family in Jesus' name. This year, the barren will have children. Miracle children. Good children. Miscarriages will stop in Jesus' name. And all the plagues of Egypt is taken away from our lives. Lord, I pray premature death will stop. Life will come in Jesus' name. Any infirmity, any sickness, I command right now, be healed in Jesus' name. This year you'll be healthy. This year you'll be strong. The blessing of God will be yes and amen in your life. Oh Lord, I pray that every good thing your people need, whether they have reaching down or they have not reaching them down, supply for them in Jesus' name. Above all, make us strong. Strong to overcome temptation. Strong to be victorious. And Lord, I pray that your joy will be in every heart. All the workers, oh Lord, I pray you strengthen them for better service. And all our members, I pray you promote them to serve you and the workers in Jesus' name. I pray this year, testimonies. This year, miracles. This year, signs and wonders. This year, a year of joy. A year of progress. A year of victory. In the day, in the night, be with your people. Confirm your blessing upon every life. Lord, I pray everyone will know God has done something. There will be no exception. Brother, sister, young, old, no exception this year. Open doors are before you. Confirm it, Lord, in every life. I thank you because I know you have answered. In Jesus' name I pray.